So welcome back to the Entertainment Lab. As we are going to give you update of what happened in Crisis of Infinite Earth Part 1, so sit tight and hold on to your seats for the next few minutes. And don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel.
Tell her I'm a dead lover.
The end of the world is licking at our heels! The end of the world!
To stop the wave of antimatter hurtling towards Earth 38, Oliver and his super friend were tasked with protecting quantum towers, which were placed by the monitor on the key Earth from the army of shadow demons. But when the threat became too overwhelming, forcing the monitor to scoop up the heroes, Oliver refused to retreat until the planet, which is ultimately destroyed, was evacuated. He kept fighting until he ran out of arrows, leaving him defenseless against the creature who critically wounded him. Barely able to talk upon being delivered to Earth's once star city bunker, a dying Oliver tearfully told daughter Mia to tell his son William and his wife Felicity how much he loves them. Then he took his final breath. In the end, Oliver's heroic actions saved many of additional people from Earth 38, giving them enough time to get on a spaceship to Earth 1. The monitor noted,
"It was not supposed to be like this. This is not his ending I foresaw."
Similarly, whilst viewers were told by the monitor, "For a while now the Oliver Queen will die," his death was not without surprise. The decision to have Oliver's lives cut short so soon into the crossover really came off from elsewhere, which strongly suggested that Oliver was going to die. And then the Arrow season finale, where we told the audience Oliver is going to die in Crisis. Crossover showrunner Mark Gunningham explained, "So the dilemma that we presented to our own selves was that we spoiled our own story. So if Oliver dying isn't the surprise, what's the surprise?" The answer, the timing of him dying, because we figured that the audience is expecting the Oliver would die in a climax of the fifth arc. Gunningham continued, "So if we went in the exact opposite direction and killed him end of the R1, we accomplished two things. Hopefully we do surprise the audience, that absolutely the intention, but when we really establish the stakes, that's going into the next few hours. If Oliver Queen can die, then no one is safe." As for how the other character will deal with the loss of their friends when the crossover continues on Monday, they all have a different take on how they grieve or handle Oliver's death. Batwoman showrunner Carolina Dries reviewed, "Some of them believe it's over. Some of them believe we can fix this. Some of them are not wanting to even think about it." And it set up really interesting story and conflict between all these characters who have different way of reacting to this tragedy. And you get to see them all grieve together in a really compelling way. Meanwhile, Kara has been hit with a double up whammy. In addition to Oliver's, she is grieving the loss of her Earth. Supergirl showrunner Robert Ronver noted, "So she comes into it wanting to try and figure out how to fix what happened, and that's in our journey, which very much with Kate, not only with Batwoman R, but in the rest of the crossover." Part 2 begins on appropriately somber note with Kara, Kate and Sarah pouring one out for Oliver's in Star Lab lounge. But Kara can't bring herself to down her shot because she is mourning both Oliver's queen death and destruction of Earth 38, which is a big deal, else the crisis won't wait for anyone. And once Harbinger acquire Earth 74's Wave Rider, the heroes get down to the business of finding the rest of Paragon. It turns out Supergirl and Sarah are the Paragons of Hope and Destiny respectively. The first Paragon search team, which consists of Kara and Kate, heads to Earth 99 to find Paragon of Courage, who is supposed to be the Bat of Future. On that Earth, they met Kevin Conroy's old Bruce Wayne, who devoted his life to crime and moves with the aid of an exoskeleton. His acting is the reason the twist that he is a cold-blooded murderer who killed the Rogues and Superman. It's surprising, and yet we are prepared for it because everything Conroy was throwing at us. Unfortunately, this is the last time we will see the particular version because Kate accidentally kills him via electrocution when she steps in to defend Kara. This trip to Earth 99 has several ramifications for Batwoman and the crossover. First and more pressingly, their fraught interaction with old Bruce Wayne ends up revealing that Kate is the Paragon of Courage, aka the Bat of the Future. Second, the encounter presents Kate with an interesting internal conflict she is hopefully have to grapple with the Batwoman returns. She just glimpsed a potentially dark future for herself. Meanwhile, Clark, Lois and Iris goes off looking for the Paragon of Truth, who is some bummed version of Superman. Of course, this leads them to Earth 167, where they encounter Smallville's Clark and Lois Lane. Bringing back Tom Welling and Erica Dorrance is some major fan service in the best way. It's so proud that it's not just that. The writers give Welling a great scene with John Cryer's Lex Luthor, who is using the Book of Destiny to kill Superman throughout the multiverse. Cries in credulity at discovering that this Superman gave up his power to have a wife and kids is hilarious, as is Welling Clark's somewhat bored reaction to this petty version of his arch nemesis. Not having Welling Clark suit up as Superman then allows the episode to go full circle Superman when Clark, Lois, and Iris travel to Earth 96 and met Brandon Routh as the Kingdom Come version of Superman. Like Conroy, Routh carries the weight of everything this Man of Steel has experienced. The Joker murdering everyone he loves at the Daily Planet and seeing him suit up again really does feel like a homecoming. But it's not all about nostalgia, because Lex Luthor forces Routh, Superman, and Hoechlin Superman to fight. Thankfully, Lois and Iris knocks Lex out and uses the Book of Destiny to become Ruth Superman, overcome the mind control. While all of this was going on, Sarah, Barry, Mia, and Constantine traveled to Earth 18 to find the Lazarus Pit, since Thea discovered all of Earth's ones and resurrect Oliver. Is this the stupid plan? Most definitely. And Sarah is very much on the fence about it, and even after Constantine promises to try to bring Oliver's soul back. But we will have to see how this threat shakes out in the Flash hour. I will say, I did enjoy Sarah and Mia butting heads and Mia coldly bringing up Nissa Al Ghul. As the episode ends, Raimi throws Superman and finishes his paragon, and Kara worries Kate when she reveals that she wants to use the Book of Destiny to bring Earth 38. Luckily, Kate pocketed some kryptonite from Earth 99 and is prepared in case Kara's hope leads her down to the dark. Speaking of dark paths, Harbinger comes face to face with the Anti-Monitor in the hour's final moment. Crisis on Infinite Earth Part 3 begins with the destruction of Earth 203, which is the home of short-lived DC TV show Birds of Prey. We see Ashley Scott, who played Huntress, parkouring across the rooftop in New Gotham as she is talking to Oracle over communication, and the antimatter wave consumes her city. Unfortunately, neither of them survive. From there, we return to the Wave Rider, which is hovering over Earth 1. The Team Flash arrives and the gangs get down to the business of looking for the remaining Paragons. Luckily for them, Ray's Paragon detector machine reveals two of them is already on the ship. The Flash is the Paragon of Love and Supergirl Jones is the Paragon of Honor. In the comics, Martian Manhunter is one of the staples of Justice League. It's nice that he will be a prominent part of the final team. Ray and Cisco's detector also reveals the seventh Paragon. The Paragon of Humanity is an Ivy Town professor named Ryan Cho. So Ray, Iris, and Ralph head out to the Ivy Town to convince Ryan Chow to join them. Ryan, the personification of nervous energy, wants nothing to do with the superhero business because he has a family he wants to get back to. But Iris, using her superpower, convinces him to join the fight. Meanwhile, Barry, Frost, and Cisco, whom the Monitor forces to become the wife again, head to the tunnel where Nash disappeared and discovered the antimatter chamber behind the metallic door Nash got sucked into. Inside, they find Earth 90 Flash trapped in a cosmic treadmill powering the antimatter cannon that destroyed Earth 2 and is the source of the antimatter wave threatening the entire multiverse. The trio helps Earth 90 Flash off the treadmill, which is actually a bad move because it will destroy the entire multiverse in one fell swoop if he does stops running. In order to delay that, Pariah Breed Jefferson Pierce from the CW's Black Lightning to the chamber to contain the energy long enough for them to come up with the plan. Eventually, Barry and Ship Flash realizes the only way to stop the cannon is for a speedster to hop on and run in the opposite direction, which would lead to one of their deaths. This is the moment Barry has been preparing all the season long and gets ready to hop on. But then Ship Flash surprises him by stealing his speed and taking his place on the treadmill. This solution works because Barry just wants to be the one to do it. He is clearly pained watching someone go through this for him. While all of this is going on, Mia, Bigger, and Constantine jump over Earth 666 and meet up with Lucifer, who plays the devil. After showing off his ability to make anyone share their desire and teasing Constantine, Lucifer hands them a card that will let them travel to Purgatory and retrieves Oliver's soul. In a surprising twist, though, Oliver isn't ready to leave because Jim Corrigan's A Spectre tells him he is destined to become something else and relight the spark. So Oliver agrees to go with him instead. From there, Mia, Diggle, and Constantine return to the Wave Rider. That's when chaos breaks out because Harbinger, who has been corrupted by the Anti-Monitor, proceeds to attack all of the heroes, kill the Monitor, and reinitiate the Anti-Matter Wave, which wipes out the last remaining Earth. In the final moments, Pariah manages to teleport 7 Paragons: Barry, Batwoman, Supergirl, Rancho, Martian Manhunter, Brandon Routh Superman, and Sarah to the Vanishing Point. the only safe refuge from the apocalyptic event because it exists out of the time and space. Their situation though escalates from somewhat depressing to downright depressing when Ruth Superman dies and is replaced by Lex Luthor, who used the scrap paper to make himself a new paragon of truth. Even during the apocalypse, Lex Luthor can't help but be Lex Luthor. Honestly, I respect that, especially because it gives a super death like in the Crisis comics without killing off Supergirl. Thank you very much for watching this video, and if you like, please hit the like button and subscribe to our channel.